mic. Ready? Hello. Greetings to everybody. Happy Sabbath to you. Morning Sabbath school. How are you? How are you today? Did you have a good week? 6 days of toil and labor, everybody. Those who went to school, exam, those who stayed at home, those who went to work, what it was like. Some would say, so far, so good, not so good, in between, I am blessed and highly favored, whichever. I dare to say to us this morning, we are grateful to be in the land of the living. Do you agree with me? If you don't, I am. And if you were to ask me, Brother Gray, how are you? I will tell you, it's good to be alive. It's good to be alive. Because guess what? The living can praise God, the dead cannot do so. We can make wrongs right and the crooked paths straight. Am I right? We are on the ground of repentance. It's Sabbath school in earnest this morning. And I hope and trust that as we fellowship and as we worship, the Spirit of God will be close to each one of us. Welcome one, welcome all. It's good to see Am I down there? We welcome you, sister, and I'm sure you are going to have a wonderful time with us today. Wonderful. All right, we'll sing. This is not our opening hymn. Just one song that we'll praise and worship. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest where, just to know, thus saith the Lord. The musician will strike up the band. After two. Here we go. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest, just to know thus, so Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him, oh God. Oh yes, Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, how far grace, oh how sweet to trust in Jesus, just in pains, in blood, just in simple faith to plunge me, lift the healing. So Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, of all grace. I'm so glad I learned to trust him. I'm so glad I learned. And I know that thou art with me, will be with me. Oh yes, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, of all grace, trust him more. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Sabbath School. This morning we look at the theme, am I enjoying the joy of salvation? It is of interest to note, family, that Jesus likened the relationship with him as to a couple. Male and female, in marriage. For many individuals, upon accepting Jesus Christ, he or she will experience excitement, enthusiasm, joy, peace, and happiness. It's just like a marriage. People in courtship leading up to marriage, we use some words, Brother Rodney, which in reality, when the tires meets the road, we forget them. Like some of our young ladies, the men would say, if a girl like you was across the sea, what a great swimmer I would be. And all these words, and we see people upon accepting Jesus. Week one, church every Sabbath, church every Sunday night, church every Wednesday night. But as days turn into weeks and weeks into months and months into years and years upon years, the same legs started to get what? Weary. And the same faith started to dwindle. It happened in the physical space of marriage. It happened for real. And we just completed 2 weeks of intense preaching. As it were, we were on Mars, and maybe past Mars. Now we are back on planet Earth, and it's regular programming. So all the excitement is over. And it seems as if, in short order, that enthusiasm soon somewhat seems to be dwindling. Sister Gail, am I right? And that first love upon completing I do with those 13 questions, forgotten. Just like, do you take this man to be your lawful wedding husband? I do. And the other side around for the lady. It's same with Jesus. It's a relationship. Unless we nurture it, it will eventually what? It will eventually die. How do we nurture it? By studying the words, by witnessing, and much meditation, and sincere prayers. Am I enjoying the joy of salvation? Some people, they are very expressive. You will see it on the facial expression that look, they are happy. Some they're happy inside, but they are not the effusive type of person who creates excitement or what of you. Some people are like that. Some people walk to the pews and you wonder, are they happy Christians? I will not judge. Yes, they are happy Christians. They are not laughing. They are not socializing as some would, but they are happy. While some will have much friends, will share jokes here and there, and it's visible, it can be clearly seen. But am I enjoying the joy of salvation? That's a question that I need to ask myself. Am I really happy as a Christian? Am I enjoying my Christian walk? Am I? Is it so boring that me can't bother come to church? What is it? It's a question that each one of us need to ponder this morning. Our opening hymn, number 602. Oh, brother, be faithful. Because we believe that Jesus is coming. 602. Shall we stand, everybody?
Oh, brother, be faithful. Soon Jesus will come, for whom we have waited so long.
Oh, soon
shall we enter glorious home
and join in the conqueror. Everybody in the chorus.
Oh, brother, be faithful, for why should we prove unfaithful to him who had shown?
Come up here, Auntie Dawn. Auntie Dawn, come and join me here.
Such unbounded and infinite love.
Sister Whitaker, come and join me here. Come, Sister Whitaker, come and join me up here.
Oh, brother, be faithful.
She's not hearing.
The city of gold, prepared for the good and the blessed,
is waiting in portal of pearl untold, and welcome thee into thy rest. Oh, brother, be faithful. Oh, brother, be faithful. Let us do number 4, the last stanza.
Oh, brother, be faithful, eternity is near. Creation omnipotent King, when legions of angels his chariot attend, and palms of victory bring.
Oh, brother, be faithful.
Pronounce the glad word. Well done, faithful servant, the title is clear to enter the joy of thy Lord.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I said, oh, brother, be faithful, eternity's here shall tell for the faithfulness now. When bright smiles of gladness just scatter thy tears, a coronet and gleam on thy brow. Oh, brother, be faithful, the promise is sure, that waits for the faithful who have tried
such deep. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Be seated, everybody. The preacher and the businessman had an encounter in the lobby of a 5-star hotel. They'd been through high school together. They'd been through university together. One became a theologian. One became a businessman. He got very, very rich, wealthy man. And so for the first time for many years, they met. Good morning, Mr. So-and-so. Good morning, preacher. How are you? I'm fine. I've seen each other for quite some time. Yes, you know I'm rich. Yes, I'm a rich man. And I noted that you is a preacher. But guess what? I would like to talk to you, but do not tell me about Jesus and the Bible. But the pastor responds, how do you expect a preacher of righteousness to have a conversation without talking about Jesus? But can't you just talk without mentioning from the scripture? No, that's impossible for me. You see, pastor, I am rich. I have my own private jet. I can travel wherever I want to. I can book in any hotel around the globe that I want to. But guess what? When night comes, I just cannot sleep. What is wrong with me, pastor? Let me tell you, Mr. Businessman, happiness don't necessarily come from your wealth or what you possess. Happiness comes from knowing Jesus. Jesus made us for himself. And without Jesus, we are empty. So we can have everything in this world, yet we fail to experience the joy of salvation. Our scripture reading, Matthew 19, 20, verse 20, 23, and 25. That's Matthew 19, verse 20, 23, and 25. Let us stand as we read this portion of the scripture. Everybody, let us stand. Verse 20 said, the young man said unto him, are we there? Let's go together, brethren. Jesus said unto his disciples, verily I say unto thee, that rich man shall all enter into thy kingdom. Verse 25, it says, heard it, they were exceedingly amazed, saying, who then shall be saved? Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this portion of your words. As we read, we discover, Lord, from your written words, that to follow Jesus, it takes self-denial. To follow Jesus, we need to understand his will for our lives. So, Father, we ask you not so much to be backed down from the things of this world or by the things of this world, but by your grace to enjoy the joy of salvation. Father, we thank you for the plan of salvation. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. And we thank you, Lord, for your promises, knowingly that one day you are coming back to take us. So have mercy upon us just now. Consecrate our lives to you, we pray, in Jesus' name. We'll now have our teachers, the units members rather, ready to do their assignments in that of welcoming the members to the unit you have not seen for maybe over 6 days. We collect our Sabbath school offerings and then we go into a lesson discussion and I will come back after I would have done so.
Paralyzed by fear, as he heard a mighty multitude was quickly drawing near. But as they prayed for deliverance, the victory would begin. For when you call upon the Lord, you summon all of heaven. So pray on, for you pray on, for this will tear those mighty strongholds down. Stay on your knees, for this is where the battle is won. Very soon you win the victory. Pray on. When Daniel faced the lions, your prayers may seem in vain. They don't seem to make a difference. They don't seem to make a change. Just rest assured, God knows your need, and he's here each time you pray. Your prayers are reaching heaven, and the answer's on the way. Pray on.
Amen. Good morning and welcome to our lesson review.
Yes, morning everyone.
So this week's lesson, Brother Walker, is worship the Creator.
Yes, worship the Creator. You know, interesting, we have been looking at, the lesson in parts, Revelation. Revelation 14 in parts. So you take it bit by bit, and you look at it bit by bit. So last week, we looked at the whole of his judgment. And now we are looking at worshiping the Creator. And this section closes basically Revelation 14 verse 7, So the memory text says, let me read the King James Version.
Thou art worthy,
O Lord,
to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things. And for thy pleasure they are and were created. And that is actually a song that I know, and I was sharing it.
Yes.
So yes.
So what this is telling us is that everything that we do is it surrounds worshiping God. You know, because our existence is to worship God. Every single thing that we do is supposed to fall in that principle, are lined up in that. You know, but we live in a world where people worship almost every and anything. We still have pagans in our world too.
Yes, yes.
People worship trees, people worship images, etc.
Yes. And I must add to that as the memory text says, that we are created, all things are created. Wow. For what reason? To worship God, and it's really for God's pleasure. So everything around us is created to give glory and honor to Christ. And so are we.
Yes.
We are created and we exist just to worship God.
But you know, it's very easy to take things for granted.
Yes.
So for instance, I wake up every morning. I mean, that's a given. I'm going to wake up tomorrow morning.
Mm-hmm. So you think, Brother, Brother Walker.
So, I mean, there's nothing special in it. I'm going to see the sun. I mean, we complain the sun is hot. Now, tonight I might see the moon, I will see some stars.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's how we think.
Yes, that's true.
So we take it for granted. You're able to walk. So you say, all right, tomorrow morning I get up off the bed, everything will be fine.
Those of us who are able to walk.
Those of us who are able to walk. You know, you take it for granted. Well, I'm going to breathe. Mm-hmm. So I wake up or I'm fine. Everything is fine. And so we take these things for granted. But the lesson tells us that the sun is so central to our existence.
Yes. So more everything. The sun, I mean, pagans worship the sun.
Yes.
But the sun is there to contribute so much.
Yes.
So many things is there as a result of the sun.
Yeah,
the very wind.
Exactly.
Colors that we see. Yeah. Every single thing is really revolving around the sun. The sun.
Yeah.
And even the planets themselves, based on how the solar system is structured, everything revolves around the sun.
So God made the sun in such a way that the sun gives life.
Yes.
And it sustains life.
Yes.
Remember, no,
God made it that way.
So it's like the sun.
In and of itself, yes,
of itself. Yes. Says, like, God programmed the sun to operate this way.
That's right.
It can't operate no other way but this way. You know, and ancient people knows all of these things, and so they start to worship the sun instead of worshiping the Creator.
So we exist to give glory to God. So, and despite all sorts of mist about the universe arising from absolute nothing, as the last part of the introductory Sabbath says, from absolutely nothing or from some kind of mathematical equation, or universe exists because God the Creator has made it and everything in it.
Amen.
And then on to Sunday, a companion in tribulation.
Yes.
And this lesson begins with John on the Isle of Patmos. I mean, we know that if we study a little bit about this, we realize that this Isle of Patmos, it's somewhere near Turkey.
Yes.
And it's not a big island. It's rocky and
it's very lonesome, and it's an island where they banish
yes
people
prisoners.
Yeah, prisoners. Mm-hmm. So depression and all of these things will just take you out.
Yes.
But the good thing about John is that John knew that he wasn't alone.
Yes. As you said, John knew that he was not alone. Mm-hmm. But the reason why John was placed there was as a punishment.
Yeah,
so as it says, a companion in tribulation. So he was there, mm-hmm. exiled, alone, mm-hmm. in quotes, according to what the persecutors then were trying to do. But John knows that
he wasn't alone.
He was not alone.
Because John, he had all of heaven. Can you imagine he had the company of angels with you, have God Himself with you, Jesus with you. So, and that's the stage that we need to reach. We need to get to the point where all human interactions are companions are cut off.
Yes.
We know that God is with us. Because what Satan does, he causes us to become depressed when we don't have a human
presence.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And so when we become depressed, we tend to do a lot of things, mm-hmm. which lead to one thing, and that's death.
Death, ultimately. Yes. Yes.
So we need to get to the point where even when your husband or your mother, your father, whoever it is, they are not present, mm-hmm. you know that God is present.
Yes.
So until we get to that point, we'll always struggle, because what we do, we put God aside and say, God, you're not good enough. What I need is something that I can touch, something that I can see, something that I can, go along with. And we all need that.
Yes.
Don't get it wrong. We all need that. But we need to have such a relationship with God that when everything else is cut off, we are with God. Jesus.
So it means that even before we get to that stage, we can know that in this time when things are going okay, mm-hmm. in quotes, mm-hmm. and even when things get worse, God is with us. So we can only acknowledge God in the bad times when we recognize that He's with us, mm-hmm. We can only recognize God in the bad times when we know of Him in the good times.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
And tribulation really only comes to help us to be stronger.
Amen.
And to be closer with God and so many things. Amen. You know, then Monday's lesson, mm-hmm. worship the Creator.
But before we skip over to Mom, I just want to read. It said, if you were to ever enter the cave where it is purported that John was visited by the heaven angel with revelations, prophetic vision, you would immediately notice these words placed on a plaque at its entrance, summarizing the entire book of Revelation.
Yes.
Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come. And worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea, and the springs of water. And that's exactly what this is about. You know, and this sums up the entire Bible itself, because from Genesis
to Revelation,
it outlines God as creator, and it tells of his creative power. And here in Revelation 14, verse 7, it summarizes all of Genesis, all of the Bible, all of Revelation, telling us that God
is to be worshipped.
Creator, and we need to worship him, because if you don't worship God, then you're going to worship something or someone else.
Yes.
And eventually you're going to lose out on his eternal kingdom. All right, so we'll move on to Monday, worship.
And Monday's lesson, worship the Creator. And even before we go to that, mm-hmm. the whole idea that God created from nothing, bara is the Hebrew word.
Yes.
God created from nothing.
Yes.
And as human beings, Dina, often say, we with our little puny cells.
Yes.
Can't always try to think that we can create, and what it is that we are creating, it's not from nothing.
No, we
take something, we're not even create, Dean.
Yeah, we don't.
We don't create.
That's right, we don't create. I was speaking to someone this week, and I said to them, some of the very, I was talking to Brother Gail. I was saying to him that some of the very symbols that you see that the occult use, is a dear symbol, is a copy of what God already has in. But because Satan doesn't have anything that is originally his apart from sin.
Yeah.
That's mm-hmm. that's it.
That's true. That's
but,
true.
What it does, because even Sunday that, we're not supposed to worship on Sunday as a day of worship, mm-hmm. but even Sunday, is that his
Sabbath,
day?
Yes, it's not a holy day.
That day.
Yes.
But it's just that God designated for us to rest and to worship Him on that day. But it's still God's day. So Satan couldn't create a different day. All right, me create this day. So I want people to worship on this. It's still God's day. So it's just, Satan is just a counterfeit person, you know, it's a trickster.
All right. So,
yes.
Monday's lesson, worship the Creator. And we look at Revelation 14, verse 7, that it says, ends with a clarion call to worship the Creator. And this, this call is essentially important when we look at all that is happening in our world today.
It is important because when you look at even the theory of evolution, evolution basically puts creation aside.
That's what
basically
it does.
Buries creation.
That's what it does.
You know? So, we as Seventh-day Adventists, you know, it's interesting that apart from the Jews and maybe some other
religions,
some other denominations that worship on Sabbath, we are the ones who, Sabbath starts from Friday evening, which
sunset.
Exactly how the Bible says it, from sunset, sunset is one day or so forth, you know. So when the very fact that we worship that way is telling you that we are going all the way back to Genesis and we are worshiping the Creator the way that He specifies us to worship, you know. So what evolution tries to do, it tries to destroy the fabric of creation, because creation tells us that we are coming from a place of perfection.
Yes.
And because of sin, we have entered into a realm of chaos, violence, disunity, all of that.
And another thing too that evolution teaches is that creation continues.
Yes.
But we know that creation ended, you know, when after at 7 days.
Yes.
So it really throws out if we, you know, and if we actually hold on to something like that, we are throwing out who God is and who He is as Creator.
Evolution is like is as many woes in it.
Yes.
It's worse than a strainer. Because strain will hold residues, but it cannot hold even in residue. The reason for that is because you said, all right, human beings evolved, and I've been here and I've been listening to human history from way back when, and I know I can't grow wings and I want two wings. You know, I haven't heard anybody say that they had any wings. So we are not evolving.
Yes.
What is happening rather is what the Bible says. Man used to live 969 years. But what the Bible says, we are decreasing. Man,
exactly.
And we right now, we are experiencing the decrease.
Exactly.
So we are not experiencing the increase that evolution speaks about.
Amen.
And
that's why
I say that. I love that. Holes in it.
I love that.
You know, so it cannot stand. You know? So evolution teaches us that we come from a place of chaos and violence and vice.
I know,
and
order.
We are going to a place of perfection.
Mm.
But that's not the case.
Oh, God is good.
Because the more we advance in technology and medicine and everything, is the worse we get. If we have eyes to see, then we realize that worshiping the Creator, as Monday says, is our best option.
Amen. So we can count on our Creator to accomplish His will.
Amen.
At the end of the day.
Amen.
In
so,
us.
Yeah. So Revelation, it appeals to us to worship God. And the thing is, it's a revelation, final appeal, then is rooted in the book of Genesis, you know. So the creation, and then Revelation 14, verse 7, calls us back to that Creator.
Amen.
Who did all of that in we spoke about the sun already, so I think we can move past that.
All right. So Tuesday, a God who is close. And, you know, I just want to put this in, that it says there is the transcendency of God, which means that He is above all and over all His creation. And then the immanence of God, which means He also is intimately involved in everything that happens to and through us.
And only God
alone.
He is above us, because the Bible tells us that His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts far
exceeds
our thoughts.
We can't even.
But yet still, is imminent, where it can live in our hearts.
Amen. Amen.
In our minds. When I say the heart, I mean the part that comes with it.
Yes.
In our minds, you know, to the point where we can live the way that He wants us to live. So what this means is that we can live above sin. You know, and sin is the reason why we are here talking about all of this, because
that's
sin,
right.
Came into this
show, that's right. And can I add to that, when we are transformed in the likeness and in the image of God, when Christ creates in us a clean heart, that too speaks to how close God wants to be with us.
Yes.
Today, even after the 7-day creation, He wants to create still in us.
I mean, yes, and even after sin.
Even after sin, He's
you
still.
You know, the introduction of sin.
You know,
so you'd expect that.
Point lead.
You'd expect that. I mean, we could use our example.
Yes.
You're in a relationship and the person cheat and all of a sudden, it done.
Mm-hmm.
But we cheated on God.
Yes.
And he even gets, it seems like he wants to get so much closer to
gosh.
Us.
Oh, gosh,
man. You know, so we cheat on him.
Yes.
And he came running after us.
Mm-hmm.
And while running after us, we set trap for him and kill him.
We really can't understand his love for us.
We kill him. And even while we kill him, say, Father, forgive him. Mm-hmm. Because they know now what they
do. Yes.
And he paved the way so that we can have eternal life. And it's just our choice that is going to allow us either to have eternal life or to be destroyed.
And as you say that, when we look at the prayer that Jesus prayed in John 17:23, that he wants to be close to us, recognizing that even as he, you know, was loved by God, he prayed that we, as we are called into the fellowship, that we will be loved of the Father just as much as the Father loved Christ.
And that's important, you know. Can you imagine God loving us just the same way that He loves Christ? I mean, that's something else. Because if you have a child and your sister or your brother have a child, I'm sure you're not love your sister or your brother's child more than you love your child. But the fact is, I mean, with God it's different. You know, because we are His children, and even though it says that Christ is His beloved Son or His begotten Son,
yes,
it doesn't mean that Jesus came or was that He was created, because Jesus was before the beginning.
Yes, yes.
So He was God all along. You know, so God loved
His creatures,
yes,
His people, just as much as He loves Christ.
Yes.
So God has to get close to Adam to create him, and He longs to draw near to us again, making us new creatures in Christ. And this should bring comfort to us, right? The gospel of forgiveness is tailor-made to bring peace about God and His presence and how close the Lord wants to be to His children, even today.
And that's why I created us in His image.
Amen. Amen. All right, Wednesday's lesson, gospel judgment and creation. Just as God was getting ready to deliver His message through the first angels in Revelation 14, Satan decided to bring about evolution and atheism that we spoke about a while ago. But the first message, or the first angel's message, was to proclaim the everlasting gospel, the judgment hour, and the worship of the Creator. And we see now that the Seventh-day Adventist Church actually pulls us or calls us back, you know, to sound that message that is heard in Revelation, that calls us to remember the Creator, that calls us to know and recognize that God created us in 6 days and rested on the seventh day, plus there is a coming judgment, and we ought to prepare for that. And the truth about God's creation and His judgment really helps us to fully understand and appreciate what Christ did for us on the cross, and that He's going to fully restore again His people to Himself when He returns again.
Amen. You know, so the gospel is a good news of salvation.
Amen. Amen.
And I think we can't leave the judgment for last. The gospel is a good news of salvation.
Yes.
But the judgment and creation, they are all tied up in one. It's a package. It's something that you can't separate, really, you know. But creation speaks of a God of infinite power,
mm-hmm.
a God who can just speak and things come into being. I mean, you can think and things come into being. You know, you command and everything stood fast. And from before sin till after sin, everything follows that command. Only a creature that disobeys as human beings up to this day.
Yes.
Mm. We are the only one. Mm. And what we do is that we get the because of our actions, the other creation.
Exactly.
Rebel as well. Because of our action, mm. while we have
the animals, party, yes.
the animals doing all sorts of things. Mm. Because when crouch on their habitat, so they say, all right, it's a warfare.
Yeah.
So the animals are warring against us. The sun is fighting against us.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we have all sorts of natural disasters, and we blame God for that. But it's our actions, because of our greed
mm-hmm.
and selfishness, that cause a lot of these things to happen. You know? So the creation speaks about a God of infinite power. You know, the gospel tells us that while God has infinite power, he loves us so much that he wants us to be a part of his
that
kingdom.
Yes.
And he wants to save us. Now, the judgment tells us that if you are on God's side, you have no need to fear the judgment. But if you are not on God's side, you need to be on his side.
Amen.
That's it. That's the purpose
powerful.
Of the judgment.
Yes, powerful.
You need to be on his side. You know, so the investigative judgment says, all right, I investigate you and you're on this side, mm-hmm. you need to be on this side
yes.
before we start executing
mm-hmm. judgment.
Judgment.
Yes.
As when judgment is being executed, you can't switch again. He that is filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still.
Very good. All right. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yeah.
So Jesus is truly our creator. Mm-hmm. All right. So Thursday, Brother Walker, the creator on the cross. So those of us who are living in the last days,
mm-hmm.
we are called to worship the creator.
Yeah.
But then we are called to worship the creator because something came between us and the creator.
Yes, because sin.
Sin.
Yes,
sin. And as a result of sin.
Like a separation.
There is the cross.
Yes.
So even that really just ties us right back to everything that we'd have been discussing.
Amen.
It's all about love. Mm-hmm. It's all about how close Christ wants to be to his creatures.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So God's people have neglected to honor the creatorship by not worshiping God. Right? The day God gave us for resting and remembering. God. So God foresaw this when he gave Moses the Ten Commandments. The fourth commandments begin with remember the Sabbath day. Amen. So we just look on Thursday. Go ahead, Brother Walker. That says, however much we can and do marvel and worship the Lord as our creator, there's more to it. As we have already seen, but worth looking at again, is the idea that our Creator also is our Redeemer.
Yeah.
The God who created us is the same God who redeemed us.
Mm-hmm.
The God who said, let us make man in our own image, according to our likeness,
mm-hmm.
is the same one who on the cross cried out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is, my God, why hast you forsaken me? So talk about the reason to fear God, and even more so to give glory to him and to worship him as well. What a powerful statement.
You know, we look at, you know, it is interesting, you know, that the same son that gives us so much benefit can also harm us. And for some of us, we look at God as only as a loving God. But the same God who created us is the same God that's going to punish us. You know, so we need to take God seriously. So when the Bible says fear God, it means to take him seriously.
And I hear you say the same God is going to punish us. Mm-hmm. And the spirit of prophecy says that when Christ returns again, we are going to be burnt up mm-hmm. because of love, you know. Mm-hmm. Because of love. In fact, we won't be able to stand in the presence of God. Right? Because sin, and we will recognize that we would have fallen if it is that we choose to not accept Christ as our creator and worship him as such.
And that's why every knee shall bow.
And every tongue shall confess. Because Christ would have already, as our creator, paved the way or made a way for us to be at one mind with him again.
Amen.
You know, so as fallen human beings, we have adequate, you know, we have sufficient reason to worship God as creator.
I know, interesting enough, you know, as I said earlier, there are many words in evolution.
Yes.
If we should believe in evolution, then we can't believe in the cross. Because it means that the creation did not exist. Sin did not come into the world. Mm-hmm. The gospel was not preached.
Oh my.
And then everything that we believe would be hinged on a lie. You know? And so because when you look at evolution, you realize that believing in evolution, there is no hope in that. You have to, and when you look at the creation story and you look at the Bible, it is filled with hope for just about everyone. So we need to hold on to God, because we see where the prophecies are being fulfilled. When you line up history, and the thing about it, you know, is that history does not deny what the Bible says would have happened way back then. And we see it coming to pass, but yet still, Satan have a way of blindsiding us. That even though we know that these things happen, we still operate as if we don't believe that they happen.
Yes.
You know? So we need to allow God to fill us so much that when we go and we talk to people, they can feel and they will know that we have authority. Not earthly authority.
Yes.
Because when Jesus was speaking, he said, no, we never hear anybody speak like this. We never feel this power before he speaks as one with authority.
Yes.
You know? And Jesus had heavenly authority. And that's what we need, that, because unless we have that heavenly authority, it is constantly going to be difficult for us to go and speak to people on the outside.
And we can only, you know, I'm reminded that we can only get this heavenly authority as we feast upon the word, and then the word becomes life. And we will give back that life to others as we ourselves would have taken it on. But as we close, can we close off this lesson? Are we? All right. So the sinner may resist the love, as we are still looking on Christ as our Redeemer. Right? The creator on the cross. The sinner may resist this love, may refuse to be drawn to Christ, but if he does not resist, he will be drawn to Jesus.
Yeah.
A knowledge of the plan of salvation will lead him to the foot of the cross in repentance for his sins, which have caused the sufferings of God's dear Son. And this is Steps to Christ, page 26, 27. So we are drawn to the creator as we see what Christ would have done for us. So everything is pointing us back to worshiping God as our creator.
And the thing is, you know, for those who don't believe in God, you have to look in the world today and look at all the promises that were made by human beings. Because when you don't believe in God, you believe in humans.
Yes.
So look at all the promises that were made. And look at how many of those promises are being fulfilled. Then look at the Bible, you know, pray and look at the Bible with an open line and look at what the Bible says. Because everything that the Bible says, it is coming to pass. We are living in a degenerate world, and this world is not getting better, it's getting worse. And the only way of escape, the only ark of safety, is accepting God's free gift of salvation. You know? So God is calling each and every one of us because he wants us, he loves us so much that he wants us to have eternal life with him, a life that is free of sickness, pain, death, even old age.
Yes.
You know, because contrary to what a lot of persons believe, God is an old man with gray hair and Jesus is a younger person. But that's not the case. God is a young person, because if he wasn't a young person, then why would he want just young people in his kingdom?
Mm-hmm.
Not young people as in the sense of, you know, as we are right now, but he will recreate us and we will not grow old.
Amen.
That's what I mean when I said young people, you know. And God doesn't want any sick people around him. Not in the sense that we are now, mm-hmm. but when he makes us new, there'll be no more sickness, no more crying, no more pain, no more death. And so God is calling us to worship him because he loves us and he wants to save us. And as I always said, this temporary life is not enough to enjoy permanent blessings.
Mm.
So God wants us to have eternal life so that we can enjoy eternal blessings.
And one thing that I often, as I hear you say that, my favorite thing, John 10:10, that Christ came so that we can have abundant life.
Amen.
And the abundant life that we are having is really as we live an abundant life here.
Yes.
So I like the point that you said that we really can't expect to be living anyhow, no one thing to inherit eternal life.
Yes.
But even as we are here on this planet, that every single one of us faces battles with temptation every day. And there's incredible good news. The same God who unleashes infinite power to create is the same God who has infinite power to create in us clean hearts so that we can truly worship him in spirit and in truth as he has called us to do such today. So let us take hold of this unlimited infinite power. The power is ours when we grasp it by faith. We are transformed, changed, and made new by the power of the Creator. And
amen.
I say, amen. Amen.
All right. So continue to tune in to Shortwood SDA. And I'm sure that God will indeed bless your heart. And, you know, the water is always troubled here. So if you need to be baptized, you can always reach out to us and you can come in. And we're happy to baptize you. We're happy to, you know, make you a part of the fellowship. So that as we study and we witness, all of us can go home together when Jesus returns the second time. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we give you thanks for your word. We thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit that has led us. It was not us, Lord, but it was you. And we ask that you will continue to be with us through the Sabbath day. Be with our online viewers. And I pray, dear Lord, that your Holy Spirit will keep us. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Amen. So join us again next week for our topic, the Sabbath and the end. Be faithful, continue to study and apply to your lives.
Amen.
Mic test. Thank you very much, teachers. Thank you. It's now 10:36. And we should close off by 10:35. Thank you. Thank you very much, Elder White. It has been a wonderful discussion in Sabbath School this morning. I see the excitement and the zeal and the enthusiasm. It's good to know that as creatures, we can acknowledge the Creator. And the songwriter mentioned, Jesus, I know, I've neglected to do the little things, the big things you wanted me to do. I've let you down, Jesus, it's not hard to say. But he requested, Jesus, oh Jesus, don't give up on me. We are talking about experiencing the joy of salvation. It's good to attend church in this physical space. It's good to have nice clothes. It's good to have a secure job. But as we sojourn this life, we encounter many things, some of which at times would cause us to depress and to feel oppressed. And so the Christian journey at times seems burdensome. And many people would ask, are you a Christian, brother? Are you a Christian, sister? But without experiencing the joy of salvation, we dare not share the joy of walking with Jesus. Jesus made salvation possible for all of us. And so I believe we should be happy people, Elder White, in spite of. How are you, brother? God is good. How are you, sister? I'm on top of my grave, been a gone under yet. Gratefulness says a lot. So I'd just like to welcome those of our visiting friends who came in to worship with us. May I see you by standing just now. All of our visitors coming for the first time, I'd just like to welcome our newly baptized members. And I must let you know that 1,000 miles begins with the first step. And I hope that you will enjoy your walk with Jesus. And for those of us who are on the old ship of Zion, I must let you know that sometimes we too, our feet gets weary. And so we have to ask God to increase our faith. But nevertheless, being a lost sinner, I know that Jesus loved me. And so as we close Sabbath school this morning, I'd just like to sing one of my favorite songs. And this one, especially for our visitors. Because all of us sometimes in our lives, we're lost. All of us, we're lost. But we thank God that Jesus saved us. I was lost, but Jesus saved me. He gave his life in Calvary Street. Though I failed him, he still loved me. Through his grace, being set free. And though I don't deserve a mansion, I was born a sinful man, though I don't deserve a mansion, but Jesus built a home for me in glory land. It was her sins that he died for all mankind. He paid the price of it, he should love us just enough to heal his land. And though I don't deserve a mansion, I was born a sinful man. Though I don't deserve mansion, but Jesus built a home for me in glory land. Yes, Jesus built a home for me in glory land. It's good to know that in spite of where we have been, what we have done, how far we have gone, Jesus, death on the cross, made salvation possible for me and for you. Enjoy the joy of salvation. Enjoy it, brethren. Let us rejoice and give thanks daily, because Jesus has paid it all. The Lord bless you all as we say bye from Sabbath School. Thank you.
In 1864, the first Adventist to set foot on European soil was the unofficial missionary Michael B. Chekowski. He first worked in the Waldensian Valleys in northern Italy and later in Switzerland, where in 1867 he founded the first Adventist church outside North America in Tromelon. In 1874, John Nevins Andrews, the first official Adventist missionary, arrived in Switzerland to continue the work of Chekowski. Today, Switzerland is part of the inter-European division of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. This territory includes 20 countries with almost 200,000 Adventists. There are Adventist publishing houses, schools, media centers, hospitals, and other institutions within this region. In Gland, Switzerland, an Adventist summer camp called La Plage has operated seasonally for years. This camp has been instrumental in changing the spiritual lives of Swiss young people. Arnaud came as a camper when he was a kid. The influence of this camp inspired him to live a life of service.
I left Switzerland to be a volunteer in Egypt, in Nile Union Academy, and I spent the year teaching English and taking care of the kids. I can say without any hesitation that last year changed my life, because I came back with the wish of studying theology. And I am now a student in theology that I would have never thought about doing that before.
Arnaud acknowledges that the spiritual environment and support during his younger years at La Plage were foundational in his later decision to serve in Egypt. Because of those positive experiences as a camper, he has come back as a camp leader over the past few summers.
So I think this place led me to many other activities and opportunities that led me to be a volunteer. Meeting the people that I met here and living those amazing experiences were the thing that motivated me to continue. I remember with friends we used to make jokes on the videos that we were making for like a kind of a recap every day. And we were making many jokes, and seeing this after many years after still brings me a smile. And I think the people that I met here and the camps, the activities, everything motivated me a lot.
The camp is limited by its facilities. It can only operate in the warmer months due to the piping and plumbing. In the colder months, the pipes freeze, making the kitchen and bathroom areas unusable. Another limitation is the kitchen. This small space needs an update with an area for proper food storage, a better layout, and new appliances. With these improvements, the camp would be able to operate year-round, opening new opportunities to serve.
There's one thing that I realized when I was in Egypt and when I came back is that Switzerland doesn't have many volunteers around the world. This place could become a center of formation, a center to help people find their vocation in the service, in the mission, in Switzerland or outside Switzerland. But I know that in the churches here, we have many young people that don't know really what they want to do with their life. And having a place like this with trainings, with help, with pastors here to help them would be a great chance for them to understand what they want to do with their life. And I can take me as an example. I never thought I would study theology before. My purpose is defined. This place could become a great, great chance for young people and members of the church or outside of the church to understand the mission and the purpose that Christ is asking us to follow.
This quarter, a portion of your 13th Sabbath offering will go to the renovations of La Plage. Your contribution will allow more programs to occur year-round and expand to more age groups. Please pray for this project in Switzerland. Thank you for your support of the offering that makes a difference in the lives of people like Arnaud.
You didn't hear me. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Mission first. Mission first. That's what we are called to do. We are called to go. Now, I just want to read a statement here from you, for you from Christian Service. It says, as his representative among men, God does not choose angels who have never fallen, but human beings, men of like passion, with those they seek to save. So, therefore, the work is not for the angels. The work is for who? The work is for who? Yes. It says men of like passion with whom they would like to see saved. And that is what we are called to do. The fact that we accepted Christ, we are called to be his witnesses to those who have not yet known him. And we here are doing that through several methods. One is our Bible school. And I would like you to know that the Bible school is up and running. What do you say? Right now we have about 5 different courses in the school. And so therefore, all we need to do is to find someone to enroll in one of those courses. It's pretty simple. And so we take the lesson to them and help them to do the lesson, and we carry them back in, and they are marked and returned, right? So that is not something hard to do. And in doing this, we are helping someone to learn about the Bible, to learn about Christ, and to learn about their soul salvation. Another method, right, is our small group meetings. Now, this is something that we have been promoting for some time now. And so far, right now, we have about 5 up and running. And I think we can have a lot more. Because in my estimation, every Sabbath school unit is a small group unit. You didn't hear me. Remember, Jesus called how many disciples? How many? Right. And so some of the Sabbath school are a little more than 12. Right, but every Sabbath school unit can be a small group unit. All you need to do is to find a location. It can be a veranda. It can be a pavement under a tree somewhere. And let me tell you something. It says that crowd follow crowd. When people see you doing something, they want to know what is happening, and they will join in. So let us go out and find a location. Every Sabbath school is assigned to a street. Find a location on your street and establish a group meeting. And street meeting. Our next street meeting is when? Tomorrow. Where? Right up here, Grandspan Drive. Some of you call it Grandspan Boulevard. But on the street sign, it's Grandspan Drive. Right up in the middle here, near our Brother Brown location there, about where we have several meetings there. So what we are saying to everyone, come on out tomorrow evening and let us swell the numbers so that as the words go forth in that community, men and women will hear the word of God and will make a decision as to which way they want to go. And so, the work is on all of us. Every single one of us, there's something for us to do, and there's something that we can do. You might not be able to conduct a small group meeting, but join the meeting. Join with those who are conducting the meeting. You can announce the song. You can do the prayer. You can invite somebody to join the meeting. So there's work for all of us to do. So let us all join in and do our part so that we can finish the work in this area. And then looking forward for Jesus to come. Let's all play our part faithfully. Mission first, I will go. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Elevitica. We are going to make sure that we move towards going there at Grandspan Drive tomorrow evening, giving the wind a mighty voice so that we can help to usher in the return of Jesus by preparing Grandspan for Jesus. What do you say? Good morning, everyone. It's so good to be here this morning, and it's so good to see you all. It's so good to see you worshiping God in the beauty of holiness. We have just talked about worshiping the Creator, and it's so good that at His command we are here this morning to worship God and to give Him the rightful place that He deserves into our hearts and into our lives. So let me welcome you all to church today, and I trust that as we fellowship and worship today, God's richest blessings will be for all of us. So if you are coming from Catabo in St. Elizabeth, or you are coming from St. Thomas in the East, or wherever you are coming from, or wherever you are joining us from, whatever parts of the world you are, we want you to know that you are welcome in this place, and we are welcoming you online as you worship with us today. May God's blessings be for all of us as we join in and give God the rightful praise that rightfully belongs to His name. So from the pastor's desk and the elder's desk this morning, we welcome you, and we trust that you will be spiritually blessed as the house will be taking that part of it this morning. Today is celebrated all over the world. Tomorrow is celebrated all over the world as Mother's Day. And from the Adventist circle, from the Shortwood Seventh-day Adventist Church, from the pastor's desk and the elders' board, we want to say how much we appreciate all our mothers. And further on, others will be saying it, but we want to make sure that we let you know that we appreciate you all for playing the part that you are playing and for being the channel through which you have produced and helped to make this place a better place. So welcome, mothers, and I trust that tomorrow, as the world celebrates it, it will be a blessing for you. We are celebrating it here today at Shortwood, and we trust that it will be a blessed day for you all. There was a business meeting that was scheduled for this afternoon after Vesper. But due to some circumstance beyond our control, we are unable to carry it on. We are unable to have it this afternoon. So it is postponed for a date to be announced very soon. We will make sure that we give you enough time to make plans for it. And by the way, members' meeting is for all of us. That's a place where, as family, as a church family, we meet together. We talk about the past, and we chart the path for the future as we plan for in our members' meeting. So we look forward to that day especially. They are from our church family here. They are those who are grieving and mourning the loss of loved ones. And we cannot help but remember our pastor and his family who has lost his father during the course of last week. And we continue to place them, the Hamilton's family, at the foot of the cross. Funeral service has not yet been planned, but by the way, you will know that not long from now. It is going to be, I was told, it's going to be in St. Anne's, because that's where the family is from. And we want to make sure that we are a part of it. So, and also their brother, Sister Anderson, who has lost a loved one. That one will be coming up sometime in the month of June. It's a delayed one and circumstance that the family has that they have to really be planning for. So that one too will be coming up in the month of June. So we pray for the family in the meanwhile that God will give them the necessary strength that they need as they go through this time of mourning. And as I said, when they being a part of the family, when they grieve, when they mourn, we also mourn, because when one have a heartache, we all share the pain. Brother Malcolm, Brother Kinglock, is a member of this church for many, many years, but somehow age has overrun him, and he's now sick, and he's now in the public hospital. He's no longer staying at Cast Lights. He's staying with a relative or somebody who takes care of him down by Bay Farm Road over there in Olympic Garden. We are making plans right now to go visit with him in the hospital and to bring a source of comfort to him wherever he is at this time. So we're going to ask that you you remember him in prayer as we continue to lift up those who are sick also. There are other members of the family who are sick. We are continuing to pray for them and pray that God will continue his healing hands upon them. Deacons and deaconesses, please remember your training. You know the dates, and you know that it's coming up very soon. We ask that you make plan, put that as a part of your calendar of events as you plan for it. All in all, we trust that as a church, we will continue to walk with God. And even as we celebrate today, as we plan for the service for today, may God's blessings be for all of us as we continue the march and the journey with God. God bless you. Enjoy the rest of the day with you.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Happy Sabbath, everyone. If you're happy and you know it, say amen. If you're happy and you know it, say thank you, Jesus. If you're happy and you know it, lift your hands and say praise the Lord. Indeed, he is worthy to be praised. It's just a privilege to come into the house of the Lord and lift up his high and mighty name after such a tiring week, Sister Nisha.
Oh yes, it was. But there is a time set aside for holy worship, yes. Holy convocation, and we are here in the presence of God physically, yes. Those who are in our immediate space, and those are from our virtual congregation or virtual congregants, we say welcome and happy Sabbath. And I was told that we are also on EJC Virtual Church. We say welcome to you also. And we are in the presence of God. So whether you are in your living room, in the confines of your home, in your vehicle, on the roadside, wherever you are, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we are happy, we are glad, and we are rejoicing in it.
Amen, amen. So if you're here or you're at home, we'd like you to just participate in the worship with us. If you want to send a clappy hands emoji in the chat, you can do that. If you want to praise the Lord in the chat, you can do that. But we're just going to lift up the name of Jesus today because he is worthy to be praised. Now at this time, yes, you choose your element of praise.
What is our theme for today, Davion?
Our theme for today is special you are.
Yes,
I know a song like that, Nisha.
God made you special.
God made you special.
Amen. Indeed. And that will be our theme. It is indeed. I don't want you to be jealous in advance.
No.
But I know you're going to be sharing in the moment, in times to come, recent time to come.
Yes,
we can
yes.
attest to that. But we are celebrating our mothers. We will be celebrating our mothers. And later on in the program, you will see how much we show our mothers' appreciation tangibly.
Indeed.
And so we are going to be focusing a little on the mothers for today, this morning, and also in the afternoon.
All right. So,
family.
Before we get there, we have some extra special persons here at church with us and some extra special persons online as well. We call them our visitors.
Yes.
If you're here for the first, the second, or the third time, I'm inviting you to stand at this time. Amen. Amen.
Welcome to Shortwood.
I see. No, man. Yes, when you said the welcome is like we concluded just now, but I see a sister. She was gonna stand up.
Yes,
the lovely lady in the blue, please stand. Yes, welcome,
and
welcome, welcome.
Beside her, but I think she has a baby, and I'm seeing another one close by. All right, welcome.
Welcome,
ahead,
welcome, welcome. So at this time, we're just gonna turn and give them the Shortwood wave. After 2, 1, 2. Welcome to Shortwood today. Now we have a special song. Anytime I host with Sister Nisha, she has to sing that song for me. Now it's her special welcome song, and it's Morning Neighbor Morning.
All right.
Yes, yeah, so we're going to do that song. Not the English version, but in the Jamaican.
The Jamaican vernacular. All
yes,
right.
Yes, ma'am. All right.
All right. So you're going to turn to your neighbor, whether you are in the physical space here or you are online, whomever you're close to, you are going to be welcoming them to worship. Morning, neighbor, morning.
Morning, neighbor, morning. Morning, neighbor, morning. So happy to see you this morning.
One more time, come on.
Morning, neighbor, morning. Morning, neighbor, morning. Morning, neighbor, morning. So hold on, Sister Nisha. Some people saying morning like the matter still in them eye and them don't wash them face it. So I'm giving you the chance to just wash your face so we can sing the song again so that we can sound happy that we're happy to see our brothers and sisters this morning.
Morning, neighbor, morning.
Morning, neighbor, morning. Morning, neighbor, morning. Me happy to see you this morning. Amen. 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 Amen.
That's how we do it in our family. So we go to our previous birthday celebrants. On the 7th, we had celebrating her special birthday, Sister Lisa Smith. And on the 9th, Ricardo Harris. And the 9th also, Paula Buchanan. We know her as Paula White, previously Paula White. She celebrated her birthday also on the 9th. Abigail Whittingham celebrated her birthday on the 11th, and we know that she got a previous birthday gift. Isn't that so? Amen. In the rebirth of her mother. Upcoming birthdays. Audrey Foote. Wow, the 14th. Look at this, Davion. The 14th. Who
yes,
are they?
Yes, so busy. So we have Audrey Foote. That's Auntie Pam. We have Janet Thomas. We have Jelani Wilson. We have Richard Russell, all on the 14th
wow,
of May.
All on the 14th of May. Charles Duffus on the 15th.
Yes, of
and
May.
And Charles is accompanied with whom?
Jeffrey Bryan on the 15th of May.
There he is, Jeffrey Bryan, also on the 15th. On the 16th, Lucille Morrison. Look who's sharing the 17th.
All right, we have Sister Shirley Nooks, one of my favorite persons here at church. And we have Darrell Castro, also on the 17th of May. Who do we have on the 18th?
Two of them, Kiefer Downer and Pastor Wadsworth Mackinac.
Yes, yes, yes.
On the 18th. Sharing another look again, Davion, on the 20th.
On the 20th, we have Sachel Dixon and we have Colin Williamson.
We have many peers there. Then our previous wedding anniversary, Thanksgivers, Milton and Joy Thomas on the 12th, and they celebrated 32 glorious years. Amen. Amen. And we have no upcoming wedding anniversary for next week. So, youngsters, you need to do something about
not,
that.
Not just youngsters, but the single people. We're not just calling it youngsters, but the single people, you know what to do. Wink, wink.
All right. So that is it from our family time. And you know what to do. The family that prays and worships together, they stay together.
Amen, amen. At this time, we'll be standing and we'll be doing our invocation as we invite the Lord's presence to worship with us, and the platform party will be coming in. Please stand.
As the praise team joins us, we'll sing, Welcome,
Welcome
Holy Spirit.
Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. We are in your presence. We are in your presence. Fill us with your power. Fill us with your power. Live inside of me. So we're going to sing it one more time. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. We are in your presence. We are in your presence. Fill us with your power. Fill us with your power. Live inside of me. At this time, we'll have our call to worship, which will be done by Ella Josephus Harriet.
All right, our affirmation of faith comes to us from one of the fundamental beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. The second coming of Christ is the blessed hope of the church, the grand climax of the gospel. The Savior's coming will be literal, personal, visible, and worldwide. When he returns, the righteous dead will be resurrected, and together with the righteous living will be glorified and taken to heaven, but the unrighteous will die. The almost complete fulfillment of most lines of prophecy, together with the present condition of the world, indicates that Christ's coming is imminent. The time of that event has not been revealed, and we are therefore exhorted to be ready at all times.
Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise Our Heavenly Father, it is with grateful hearts that we come into your presence today. Lord, we come into your presence because we need a blessing. We come into your presence, Lord, because we want to have sweet fellowship with you. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will be poured out on this congregation today. Pray that the message you have in store for them, they will receive. And in the end, we'll all leave here praising you. In Jesus' name, amen.
At this time, we'd like to welcome the church as we begin our praise and worship. And those online, I ask that as we sing that you will join with us so that we can have a glorious time. This is my desire. Is that yours today?
All I have within
Praise God.
Praise Him.
Our next song will be My Jesus, My Savior. Lord, there is none like you.
Giving the Lord glory and honor, and I like the way we always sing today. But we are going to step it up a notch higher. We're going to sing number 428. Oh, there's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith, let us see it afar. As we sing to His name, honor, and glory.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and
To number 341, we're going to do the quick version. To God be the glory. Man. Great things He has done. He has taken us through this week of toil and trouble and sorrow and everything. 341.
To God be the glory. Great things He has done. So lovely the world that He gave us His Son. To Him and His life and atonement for sin. And open the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear His voice.
Number 532, day by day, and with each passing moment, strength we find to meet our trials here. Five thirty-two.
trust thy promises, O Lord.
That I
lose not faith, sweet consolation offered me within thy holy
again. Help me then in every tribulation so to trust thy promises, O Lord, that I lose not faith's sweet consolation offered me within his holy word.
Help me then in every tribulation so to trust thy promises, O Lord, that I lose not faith, sweet consolations offer me within thy holy word.
Help me, Lord, when toil and
trouble meet. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meet. Here to take us from our father's hand. One by
number 467. Life is great, so sing about it.
Love.
seated.
Amen. Life is great, so sing about it. And we are singing praises to our mothers today. You have such an awesome responsibility. And I shift that to the pronoun we. We have such a privileged and an awesome responsibility to shape the lives that God would have entrusted in us. And you would have seen the fruit of your labor, those whom you would have influenced positively. And even if you have influenced negatively, then God has a way of shifting and turning that around, because that's why he is God. He can do the unexpected, that which we can't seem to fathom. And so at this time, we are celebrating with our mothers. And so I invite our visiting mothers to stand. All right, we have no mothers with, all right, I'm seeing them. And you will be given a token, and this is saying, we remember you and we are celebrating with you. Then we ask our mothers among us to stand as well, as you are gifted with a token. While we listen to this poem, it says, wonderful mother. God made a wonderful mother, a mother who never grows old. He made her smile of the sunshine, and he molded her heart of pure gold. In her eyes, he placed bright shining stars. In her cheeks, fair roses you see. God made a wonderful mother, and he gave that dear mother to you. And grandmas too. While we honor all our mothers with words of love and praise, while we tell about their goodness and even their kind and loving ways, we should also think of grandma. She's a mother too, you see, for she mothered my dear mother as my mother mothered me. And amen. This author is unknown, but we really praise and we give adoration to our mothers. And if you have not given, if you have not been given a gift, just indicate, our ushers are taking note, so we'll get our gift to you. You may be seated.
Amen. So to celebrate with our mothers as well, the communication department, we put together a very special video for our mothers tomorrow. It will be released tomorrow. I won't tell you the time, but if you subscribe to our YouTube channel, you'll know when we go live. So if you're a mother and you're interested in seeing this special video, it's now your time to subscribe so that when we release the video tomorrow, you can review it. You don't want to miss it.
All right, yes. And so we are focusing now on prayer. The breath of our souls. This is a time when we storm heaven. And what is our prayer focus? We are a church with the church in our heart. And so we are looking at our students, our academic staff, our ancillary staff. The prayer focus will be done for our students who are sitting exams as well, and our parents who will see this process through. We'll be focusing on those who are sick and grieving, those who are also grieving. So this is the time in our worship. As the person who is responsible for prayer, as they get ready to pray on our behalf, we will stand and sing, I need the prayers of those I love, while traveling through life's weary way. Please stand
and just to add as well, being that tomorrow is Mother's Day, we know we have some mothers with a burden for a wayward child. We have some mothers with a burden for a child who has left the fold and has not yet returned. We would like to pray for those wayward children and those brothers and sisters and children who have left the fold so that they can find their way back to the fold. And we'll pray for these mothers as well, that God will continue to give them the strength to hold up their family in prayer. There is no prayer like a mother's prayer. So at this time, even a mother, my mother, will be praying for the mothers of the Church of Shorthood.
God, as we learned this week, you ought to be worshipped because you are God. You created us and you made us in the likeness of your image. And so we stand before you this morning as your children. Father, when we look at what worship is, we have not begun to worship you yet. Heavenly Father, when we look that if we don't worship, if we don't have a worshipful life, we're not existing. We're so happy this morning that we're not a genetic mistake. We're happy this morning that there's no evolution because you are God. You knelt down and you breathed your breath into us this morning. And so we should understand that you're worthy to be praised. You gave us the voice to worship you. And this morning, we worship and adore your most holy name. Father God, you're wonderful and mighty. Worthy is your name this morning. As we come before you this morning, we want to acknowledge you, dear Lord, that you are God of all gods. Heavenly Father, before me are mothers. This is where the world started. If we did not have a mother, we would not have been existed, Lord. You made mothers to nurture us, to care for us, to care for us in a way, dear Lord, as if it's our own heart inside of us, our children, our husbands, our families. Before me are mothers who are broken. Broken because their children are not here in church. Broken because their children are wielding guns or taking drugs. Broken because their children are depressed this morning. Broken because their children are taken over by the devil. The devil is a liar this morning. There's some mother who is crying out in her heart because she's sick. She's sick, Lord. She's sick with pain in her head, her belly, her feet, her back, Lord Jesus, in the mighty name. Touch her this morning and heal her from the crown of her head to the sole of her feet. There's some mothers who can't find food to give their children or money to send them to school. We have single mothers. We have mothers who have fathers in the home, but yet still they're single mothers. Father God, we thank you for them this morning, and we pray that you will provide all the necessary things that they need to live and to survive. This morning, I want to place all those students who are taking exam, whether it be CXC or end of term, whatever the exams may be, help them that to understand that they need to put you first in their lives, and you will help them with whatever it is that concerns them. Some of our students are not so bright, some are bright, but yes, still, Lord, we know that you will equip them with whatever they need to know to pass these exams, especially the ones who are doing CXC. It might be difficult to do all 8 subjects, but this morning, in the mighty name of Jesus, I ask that you will come through for them. Heavenly Father, remember the administrators at the school. Remember the staff in the school, the teachers. School is getting so difficult. You don't want to teach. You don't want to go to school because we have gunmen and prostitutes. We have murderers in school, Lord Jesus. Our children are murderers and thieves and thugs and scammers in school. So we are afraid, Lord God, to go to school. But this morning, in the mighty name of Jesus, the devil is a liar. And we know that you're stronger than the devil this morning. And Heavenly Father, you will work your will and your way in the lives of our administrators. Heavenly Father, this morning we have people who are mourning the loss of loved ones, Lord God, especially our under shepherd. This morning we want to place them before you. We want them to understand that you love them with an everlasting love. Death is not of you, dear Lord, but if we are born on this earth, we must die. But Heavenly Father, the most important thing is that after death, Lord God, comes the judgment, and if our lives are right, we will hail you as our personal savior from sin. So comfort them, Lord God. Bring peace to their hearts and understanding. Help us to support them in whatever way we can. We thank you, Lord, for everything. We thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. It's not a mere act while we're here this morning. You took us through the week, through challenges and victories. And so we bring our worship this morning to you. Help us to understand, dear Lord, that we need to worship right throughout the week to bring our worship to you on a Sabbath. Some of us, we only worship on a Sabbath, Lord. But help us to remember that our worship is a lifestyle. And you, Heavenly Father, you expect us to worship you because you are Creator God. So we just want to thank you this morning for all that you have done for us, for your blessings upon our lives. Heavenly Father, for all the things you have in store for us, no matter how it looks dim, no matter how it looks dismal, but if we trust in you, dear Lord, you will come through for us. So we thank you this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. We pray. Amen.
Friends to cry for me, to bear my tempted soul above.
And his goodness keeps running after us. And he has blessed us tremendously that we can bring a gift into his temple courts to return unto him. At this point in time, I'll ask our deacons to stand in place as we return to God the gift of his blessing that he has poured out tremendously upon us. Let us continue to give thanks, because it is in giving that we receive. As we open our hands to give to God, he places a blessing in our hand, and he continues to bless us tremendously. Shall we bow our heads as we pray? Heavenly Father, we enter your temple courts with thanksgiving and praise. But more than anything, Lord, we come with our tithes and our offering that you have blessed us with to return unto you. Help us, Lord, that we will give willingly and conscientiously, knowing full well that you continue to bless as we give. So, Lord, may we continue to trust you, and may we continue to live for you, for now and even forever. Amen and amen. God is the greatest giver, and there is nothing we can give, or we can't give enough, that God cannot bless us. God will always be there, and he will always open the windows of a blessing to pour us out tremendous blessing that we'll have not room enough to receive. Elder Hardy.
Mission First. Who sends you? So send I you to labor unrewarded, to serve unpaid, unlearned, unsought, unknown. To relief, to suffer scorn and scoffing. So send I you to toil for me alone. So send I you to bear the bruised and broken, for wandering souls to work, to weep, to wake, to bear the burden of a world aweary. So send I you to suffer for my sake. So send I you to loneliness and weary. Old heart a hungry for the loved unknown, to bear the burden, friend and fair and dear one. So send I you to be my love alone. So send I you to live your life's ambition, to die to dear in self when will resign, to labor long and love where men revile you, so send I you to lose your life for me. So send I you to hearts made bare and hatred, to eyes made blind because they cannot see, to work to take and take them to the greeting. So send I you to taste of Calvary. As the Father hath sent me, so I send you.
Things which are proper for sound doctrine, that the old man be sober, reverent, temperate, sound in faith, in love, in patience, the older woman likewise, that they be reverent in behavior, not leather, not given to too much wine, teachers of good things, that they at present the young woman to love their husband, to their children, to be discouraged, chasing homemaker, good, obedient to their own husband, that the word of God may not be blasphemed.
Compassionate Father, we're truly grateful to you this morning for the privilege of worshiping you. We bow in penitence at your feet, mighty God, thanking you, O Father, for the joy of knowing that you're right here with us. This morning, O God, I place our speaker before you. the one that you have ordained to break the bread of life to us. I pray, O Almighty God, that you will anoint him from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. I pray, Almighty God, that as you stand before your children this morning, we will not see him, but we will hear you speaking through him. We pray, O God, that you'll give him words from on high, words that will touch our hearts, that as we listen, we'll recognize, O God, that you are calling us. I thank you, mighty God, for just being our friend, our guide, our sustainer, our deliverer. You're just everything to us. And I pray, O God, that if we have visitors here this morning, they will recognize through the speaker's words that you are calling them. Those who have not given their lives to you, I pray, Jesus, that they will come and taste and see that you are good. Yes, it is such an awesome privilege, mighty God, to call you our friend. And so I place our divine service before you this morning. And I pray, O God, that those who may have come feeling broken and disheartened, they will leave with a joy in their hearts. Continue to bless and keep us now, I pray, Almighty God. Continue to let your face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. And give us your peace, we pray, in Jesus' name.
What a refreshing.
Indeed.
What a refreshing moment that was to hear from our God.
Yes.
As Sister Jones intervened on our behalf. We are at that point where we will be listening to the spoken word. So we have been listening to the ministry of the word in singing. We are now going to be listening to the word from the throne room directly. Coming in the chat, I'm seeing from Kenya. I'm seeing worshipers all the way from Kenya. On Gaga, I'm hoping I have pronounced that correctly. Worshipping with us from Kenya. I'm seeing from on the EJC platform. And I'm also seeing some familiar names. Sonia Walters, Ainsworth Searchwell, greetings from New York. And from all over, we say, spread the word, share the link, because a word is coming to someone just now who needs to receive it. And you are the medium through which this person will receive the word of God.
Indeed.
And so right here in our very presence is Elder Claudette Ginas, and she is worshiping also with her beloved husband. And we say welcome to Shortwood, and we know that you will be richly blessed among the other visitors who have chosen Shortwood as their place of worship. Who will be delivering the word of God?
Well, first of all, if you're just joining us, just a reminder, the theme for today is Special You Are.
Thank you.
So the speaker will be coming to us shortly and will be sharing with us who is this special person. So to speak to us today is a man I've known all my life.
Yes, can I say the same thing?
I believe so. I believe so. Yes. He's been a son of the soil here at Shortwood. We all know him. He has served in several different capacities here at Shortwood, not just on Sabbath, but he also served the Little Angels Early Childhood Development Center as one of the former principals, and currently he works at the Kingsway High School. He's also a master guide. He was also a drum corps leader. He's a man of many hats, and if I was to stand here today and say all of them, we wouldn't finish. But most importantly, he's a man of God.
Amen. He's married.
He's also married.
Happily married.
Indeed, indeed. To Sister Annette McNeish. I'm not seeing her. No, she's not here. Okay, you'll see her another time.
She's watching.
Yes, she's watching online. So welcome, Sister McNeish. I speak of none other than Elder, or First Elder, Elder Dave McNeish. As he come, please pray for him, that the words will come directly from God and that someone will be blessed by the message that he brings to us today. But just before he comes, Elder Hardy will bless our hearts again with a meditation song.
My stubborn will at last hath yielded. I would be thine and thine alone. And this the prayer my lips are bringing, Lord, let me in thy will be. Sweet will of God, still fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee. Sweet will of God, come fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee. I'm tired of sin, foot sore and weary, the darksome path hath dreary grown. But now a light has risen to cheer me. I find in thee my stay, my thy precious will, O conquering Savior, doth now embrace and compass me. All discords hush, my place a river, my soul a friend in thee find rest. Shut in with thee, O conquering Savior, my wayward feet doth dreary roam. What peace from thee my soul shall sever. In Jesus Christ my God and throne, sweet will of God, come pull me closer till I am wholly lost in thee, sweet will of God, still fold me closer till I am wholly lost in thee.
Amen, church. You talk about vintage. You talk about vintage. Now, I must tell you that run about this time, this evening, tonight, into tomorrow, you have to pay big, big money to go to the hotels and those places to listen to some good old-time singing for Mother's Day. We don't pay a cent for it here today. We have gotten vintage from our own brother Hardy. Give him a better amen than that, man. That's one thing with a good soldier. He's going slower than before, but he's still going. He's still going. A couple weeks ago, Brother Hardy said to me, Ella McNeish, and what is going to happen if you sing at church again? I said, no, Brother Hardy, don't worry yourself, man. You're going to sing at church. And here's Brother Hardy. Singing is heart out for the Lord. Now, and what better day than today being Mother's Day? Mother's Day. I don't know what happened, friends, but listen to what happened to me now. Thanks, the O's, for their few words, few kind words. I must thank them. Hear what happened. When I heard of this appointment, I knew what I was going to speak about. I decided that on everything. And well on my way, I set a good foundation, had the base and everything in. And just finishing up now, you know, when you're finishing up, putting on the finishing touch for the message. And Ella, I went for the final paintbrush to put on the finishing touches. And when I did that, I recognized that if I came to you the way I had planned, I wouldn't be coming to you straight. And at the 11th and a half hour, the Lord said, no, you better change course. And I had to change course and get to my destination for you today. And I obey the Father and I change course. I don't know who I should change course for that is here today, but I change course. And I got a message for someone today. Listen carefully. If the message is for you, take what's for you. If it's not for you, demand something from it, because you can't leave here empty-handed today. Everybody will leave here with something today. It's a good thing to be in the house of the Lord. It's a good thing to be speaking to you on behalf of the Lord today. Now, I must tell you firstly that I am not worthy. You see me here smiling, I am not worthy. I am wretched, I am filthy, I am everything. But because of the blood of Jesus, I can be here speaking to you today. They mentioned my wife earlier. My wife is not here. Normally she would have been here because she's my second speaker. When I look at her, I get the strength, you know. She's not here today. I don't know who I must look at today. I see a good friend in the congregation who traveled from far to be here, and she made sure that she sit right in front of me. My wife not here, so I look at her with a lot of inspiration. She's not here because Amaya is not well, she's not well, and so she had to stay home with her today. She's watching, both of them are watching. I spoke to them a little earlier, and they are watching, and they are supporting me. So just pray for her that she'll get well soon and she can be back out. Let us bow our heads as we pray. Father, we just want to thank you for the privilege of speaking to your people on your behalf. Lord, I pray that I will be obedient to you today, and the message that you have for your people, I will deliver it. Come near to us now, I pray, in Jesus' holy name. Now it's Mother's Day, and we have mothers here who have never given birth. Can you believe that? Is that possible, Elariet? We have mothers here who have never given birth. But they are mothers, Sister Ferguson. They have mothered many children through the schools and through their homes, and many, many children they have mothered. So I don't want you to feel left out today because you have never mothered a child. You are a mother indeed. And so the message is for you as it is for those who have mothered children. There are some here who they have not reached a place yet to mother a child. There's something also in the message for you. Special you are indeed. You are special. Special you are. It's possible. It's possible to have a beautiful home. Beautiful house. Sorry, a beautiful house. The best house on the street. The best house in your community. But an ugly home. Beautiful house, but an ugly home. But it doesn't have to be that way. This morning I'm telling you, it don't have to be that way. The pretty house, yes. The ugly home don't have to be. You can have a truly beautiful home, and you can be a beautiful mother. As we honor mothers today, you are the major player in our setting here today. Mothers, as you listen to the scripture reading this morning, from Titus chapter 2, verses 1 to 5, Paul's letter to Titus says, "But speak thou the things that become sound doctrine." He addresses both the older men and the younger men. And he addresses to the older woman and the younger woman. But I love it from this version, the Philip's version. And it says from the Philip's version, "Now you, Titus, must tell them the sort of character which should spring from sound teaching. The old men should be temperate, serious, wise, spiritually healthy through their faith and love and patience." That's for the older men. Similarly, he said, the old woman should be reverent in their behavior. They should not make unfounded complaints and should not be overfond with wine. Never. He said that they should be examples of the good life, so that the younger women may learn to love their husbands and their children, to be sensitive and chaste, home lovers, kind-hearted, and that you appreciate the seriousness of the matter you are dealing with. Your speech should be unaffected and logical, so that your opponents may feel ashamed at finding nothing in which to pick hold.
holds. Sorry. So your life should be such that those around you, even your enemies, should not find any fault. They can't, no matter how they try, they can't find any fault in you as mothers in Zion. We must live our lives, all of us, we must live our lives so that in every respect they will adorn and do credit to the teaching of God, our Savior. Mothers, your responsibility is to be an example. As mothers, your responsibility is to be an example, making beautiful the doctrine of God. That's what you're called as mothers for, to be good example. We must live our life that way, mothers. You must live your life that way. Now, I must tell you that today's generation, the generation of today, and I have it to deal with, I have them to deal with on a daily basis. The generation of today is like a ship. A ship that lost its moorings. And by moorings here, I'm talking about the cord that holds the ship at port. That's what I'm talking about. They have lost, like a ship that has lost its mooring, no rudder, no compass. They are drowning in the sea of information. Today's young people, at the tip of the, as a matter of fact, I am in class sometimes, and when I did my plans and everything, and we are going through the lesson, and a question is asked and I can't answer, I said, go to your phone and help me to find the answer. And in seconds, they find the answer. That's where they are. Information is at their fingertips. There are so many seminars and so many conferences, ever learning, but never coming to the knowledge of truth. Ever learning, but never coming to the knowledge of truth. I am amazed at what some churches today are debating. What they are debating. They are debating all different type of things that have nothing to do with your soul salvation. That's what they're debating on a daily basis. They have not based their debate on the word of God. And that's what is important today. Our church needs to be teaching and talking and letting our young people and our church members know what the word of God is saying. That's what we ought to be doing. Without it, we'll be watching the death of marriages. Yes, many marriages are going down because the mothers, the old mothers of Zion, have not been educating, have not been guiding the young marriages. The mothers who should be doing that are not doing it. And so many marriages are dying. Many homes have become homicide centers. The family is dying because mothers, senior mothers and mothers, have not been reaching out as they should. We have very real enemies out there, real enemies. You know what we're up against, family? You know what we're up against? We are up against immorality. Immorality because the young ladies today at age 16 can tell their boyfriend, come let us have sex. And their parent can say nothing about it. That's what we are up against. The parents can say, but they can't do nothing about it because the law, if they don't be careful, they will be pulled to prison rather than the little children. Little children, I say. I'm saying that we are up against the enemy of adultery.
If we don't teach them right and train them right, adultery will take over. It is already there. We are up against homosexuality. Right before our eyes, we're up against homosexuality. All of those are enemies of the family, enemies of the home. I listened to the news this week, and I heard that the University of the West Indies, they're about to pass some laws that will we are up against it. As mothers, you need to train your children aright. It is out there before them, and there's nothing you can do. A couple weeks ago, a couple months ago, I was watching something they sent to me about some gentlemen. They were singing. It's a choir of men, and they were singing, beautiful singing. And after they pause in the middle, one of the gentlemen started talking, and he said, "Look here, we are coming. We are coming for your children. And there's nothing that you can do about it." They're talking about same-sex lifestyle, and there's nothing you can do about it. They're talking about the rainbow people, and they said there's nothing you can do about it. Mothers in Zion, we have to train our people aright, because the enemies are there. And listen to what's happening now. My sister is saying that they're telling lies. Look at what's happening. You have a baby, a young baby, and the baby is not yet born. And you give that baby your phone, and that baby can open your phone. Not yet born. Not yet born. What am I saying? They are coming through the phones. They are coming through the tablets. Many of us today, we're not training our children. The tablets are. They are coming. And so we are saying today, mothers in Zion, take back this generation. That's what we are saying. You are called upon to take back this generation. Because they are coming. The enemies are there. Enemies of homosexuality, enemies of abortion, enemies of this of the pill immediately after sex that can do. Hey, they are coming. Many people believe that these things are right today. Many young people, they don't know any different, because that's what they are hearing from their friends. They don't know any better. Because our mothers in Zion have not taught them better. We need to take back this generation. We need to take them back. Many of them are gone to crime. And let me tell you, it's very influential. Don't believe that because your child is in your home, your child was born in the Adventist home, that child won't go to school and join a gang. Don't ever believe that. Because if you're not giving them love and showing them love, the gangster outside will give them love and show them love. And before long, they'll be dedicated not to you, but to their gangster friend who's showing them love. So mothers in Zion, we need to show them love. We need to teach them what is right from what is wrong. What is right from what is wrong. We need to teach them. Paul helps Titus by mentioning three areas for godly women. The first area is the legacy she leaves. The legacy you leave behind. Holy in her lifestyle. She sets an example for younger people. In verse 3, tell us that in behavior as becoming holiness. So you teach them to become holy young people.
That's how the way of the Lord. The word holiness is related to the priest who coming out of the temple, you can smell the incense of his garments. There are some people, when you get around them, you can sense the presence and fragrance of God around them. That's how you are to be. When the sisters, when the brothers come around your mother, they need to sense the presence of godliness around you. That's how it ought to be. That's how it ought to be. So the first one is what the legacy that you're going to leave behind. The second one is godly in your speech. Your speech must be godly at all times. You should not be a warmonger. Someone who spreads scandal. So what all your daughter can hear or your son can hear, the children can hear you on the phone, is gossiping about someone else. Is talking the bad news, of tearing them down, of talking negative things about them. That should not be. Your speech at all time should represent God. Should not be accusing other people around them because they are listening to every single thing. They are hearing every single thing and their characters are being molded. You wonder why? You wonder why some pastors and some elders and some church members who have been in church for many years and leaders, you wonder why your child grow and when they become a teenager, they leave the church? Check back in your life and see what you used to do. See what you used to do. The third one is free from addiction. They need to be free from addiction. Not just the addiction of wine. But we can be addicted to just about every single thing. Did you know that you can be addicted to studying God's word? Did you know that? You can be addicted to studying God's word. Studying God's word can be so much a part of your life that your family knows that mommy will never do that. At this time of the day, they know that their mother is praying or their father is reading the scripture. That's what they see. You are addicted to it. Make sure that you're addicted to the positive things in life. Make sure that you're addicted to the good things in life. You're called to be the teacher of good things. God calls you to be the teacher of good things. We need godly mothers and godly grandmothers teaching younger women that which is good. Who else can show the younger woman how to establish a godly home? Who else? Can the world do that? Can school do that? It's the home that's going to do that. It's mothers in Zion who's going to take the young married couples under their arms and say, come, this is how it is done. I have done it for 30 years, 20 years, 40 years. Come, let me show you how it is done. Instead of criticizing, talking about mothers, talking about, oh, the frock is too tight and too short and the hairstyle is too colored, and that's not what you're called to do. You're called to lead them to a godly life. That's what you're called to do, to teach them and to lead them to a godly life. Help them to establish a godly home. Yes, they are young. Have devotion with them on Friday nights. Have devotion with them, the young couple. Take them under your wing and guide them. That's what he's saying. There are some persons getting married and they will spend a large sum of money, millions of dollars for the wedding. As a matter of fact, the wedding is so big that it has to come in the paper. The wedding is so big that Facebook has to see it instantly. That's how big the wedding is. Millions of dollars to get married. Mothers and grandmothers, it's not the money, it's not the marriage that's important, it's the life after the marriage.
That quality money should be spent in helping to make the home a good home. A good home. Verse 4 will tell us that, tell us about the love she learns. Teach the young woman to love their husbands. Hey. Teach the young woman to love their husbands, to love their children. I have discovered that more than 50%, maybe 60%, maybe 80% of the children that are born were not planned for. Well, it wasn't a planned pregnancy. But because people are married, yeah, when the child comes, a child is there, so, you know, but they are not planned for. And because they were not planned for, then the quality of love that that child should get, that child doesn't get. And so that child becomes an hindrance to the father who can't have enough time with his wife as he used to have. Sometimes to the mother too, who can't have enough of her husband as she used to because she has to spend more time with the child. We need to teach them to love their husband and love their children. I want to talk about loving our husband. We are talking about real love now. Not the play love. Some people have something called puppy love thing. That is, you hear the song say puppy love? It's not the puppy love thing. It's a real love. Teach them to love their husband. Not the soap opera one where you live a big glamour life and that's it. That's not it. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about real love. Real caring for and loving care. And let me tell you something. You see, when there's a connection in the home, the children will know. Don't worry yourself. When there's hypocrisy in the house, the children will know. We are saying that teach them mothers, teach the youngsters how to love their husband and love their children. Loving their child. The best love a child, you best love a child with the three T's. There are three T's that I'm going to introduce to you now. First one is, you need to tell your child you love them. You need to tell your child you love. There's nothing sweeter to a child than to hear you say, I love you. For some people that is very hard because they don't used to hearing it or saying it. When you have a child, you must tell them that you love them. You know why? Because there are many outside here who are ready and waiting to tell them that I love you. And if they don't used to hearing it, then they will gravitate to I love you over there. Tell them I love you and do it over and over and over again till it becomes something that they are used to. Whenever they see you, they just see love coming from you to them because they have heard it so often. Touch them. There's magic in a touch. There is magic in a touch. Touch your children. Touch them. Hug them. Kiss them. And don't let nobody tell you foolishness. So you can't kiss your son's father. You can kiss your son. Love them. But you see, we are so warped. The society is so warped. Are so warped our minds that we believe that it is wrong. It is nasty. It is dirty to do some basic loving kind things. Touch them. Touch them. And the final T is teach them day by day. Teach them by your example. So let them see you having devotion in the morning. Let them see that. Let them see you reading your Bible. Let them see you. Let them hear you singing songs in the house, godly songs. Let them see you going to church. Teach them. They're going to follow you. And whatever you give them, that's what they will become. You're wondering a little later. when you want them to come to church, when you want, and they are not coming, because you not used to come to church. You don't used to come to church Sunday night and Wednesday night. You come to church late in the morning. They are ashamed to go into their Sabbath school class because they are late. That's what they are used to. So when they grow a little bigger and don't want to come to church, why you want to kill them and beat them? When did you teach them that? You teach them that. So I'm saying to you, friend, teach them. So the three T's are what? Tell them you love them. Touch them constantly. Hug them. Kiss them. And then you teach them daily how to serve the Lord and love the Lord. The lifestyle you live, verses 3 to 5 tell about the lifestyle you live. Your lifestyle, mothers, is very, very important. Very, very important. Discreet. You should be discreet in what you do. Sober-minded. That means you should be sober-minded. You should be sensible. You should be using good words around the house. Hello? Good words around the house. You should, even when you're making up your shopping list, they should involve. When you're making up your breakfast and food list, they should be involved. Let them feel important. Let them push and say, hey, take it, this me have, and you have to eat it. And you don't want to eat it, you beat them. Don't do that. That is something of the past. When my grandparent didn't have much sense. Well, she had sense, sorry about that. She had sense at a certain level. She did not understand the power of touch. She did not understand the power of helping a child to be a part of. It was their way and their way only. Those are days of the past. How dare you talk back or ask your parent a question when she said, get up? You say, why? How dare you do? You get a lick. But some people are the high, but some people get, no, you get a couple licks first, and then the high come after. So you know, so you better go under the table. Under the table. That is something of the past. Today's generation, they are so exposed that there's nothing, anything you can tell them now, they know that already. So when you think, say, you big and mighty, I am the mother, and I'm the father, and, hey, them pass you a long time. Bring them in, and train them, and teach them, so that they can be a part of, so that they can be an example, not just in your home, but at school, and in the community, and at church. Wherever they go, they can be an example, because they would have been well trained by you as their parents. I'm saying you must be discreet with what you do. You must be discreet. Involve them in the shopping. Involve them in just about everything you do. You want to change the color of the house? Ask them about it. Get their opinion. You might not use it because they might want you to use a color that people might pass and wonder what kind of place that over there. But get their opinion. Tell them why it's not best to put it here. I'll put it in your room. I'll put it on one wall in your room. Let them feel important. You're building self-esteem. You're building attitude. You're building a leader. You're building someone who can stand on their own. But when you push them aside, when you leave them out of everything, how do you expect them to behave when they go out there and other people are giving them the bad things? How do you expect them to respond? And then you feel shame. The Bible says, when a man finds a wife, he finds what? A good thing. Thus, she is to do him good and not evil all the days of her life. Amen, gentlemen. Those who are a wife find, feel good. They should do us good all the days of their life. That's what it said. See to it that your kids understand what the Bible teaches. Let them, and it's your duty to ensure that they understand what the Bible teaches. It's your duty to do that. The next thing, Proverbs tells us that a man should... Proverbs 31 verse 12 said that, all right, about the husband finding a good man. Now we should chase them. You should be a chaste person. You should be pure as a mother, a grandmother. You should keep yourself pure for the one you're going to marry. Oh, what am I talking about? That's something of the past. That's something of the past. You can't go anywhere and tell them, young people nowadays, keep yourself chaste for your wife, for your husband. Or man, keep yourself chaste for your wife. You're crazy. That is something of the past. Me not buy. Finish it for me. Me not buy no. Pussy not bag. The man will tell you that. And the girl will tell you that. Me if you know where me are. Get. That's where the world is today. But is that what God is saying? That's not what God is saying. But if you don't tell them and show them that, when they go out there and see everybody else doing it and hear everybody else saying it, what will they do? What do you expect them to do? They should be hearing the good, godly thing from home first. So when they go out there, when they hear that, they can make an intelligent choice. That's what God requires of us as parents, as mothers. That's what God requires of us. Some mothers today are giving their daughters birth control pill. Yes. She had do it already, so better she protect herself. In the first place, she should not be in the place where she's doing it. That's in the first place. But if she's doing it already, you need to bring her to the godly place and tell her what is wrong and right. Don't promote the habit, the practice. Don't promote it. But you should be helping her. You are to teach them just the opposite of that, the pure and the chaste. Don't think that the schools are going to teach you. Because in the schools, they are giving out condoms. So if the schools are giving out condoms, what do you expect? What godly thing do you expect them to teach your child? Tell me now. Mothers, it has to come from home. It has to come from the base. It has to come from there. The last place on earth kids need to learn about sex and sexual morality is in the school. And let me tell you something. Even nowadays, some mothers inside here and some people afraid to hear the word sex. Some adults inside here afraid. They said, no, elder, don't talk about that up there. Don't talk about sex up there. Let me tell you something. They know about sex. They'll watch sex. They hear sex. They talk about it at school. So when you don't want to tell them, they are knowing about it anyway. So you first tell them. Don't make those, because a lot of times those who are telling them, their minds are warped and corrupt. They know nothing about God. So they are telling them what they know, and they are showing them what they know. I was a young lady yesterday. We were just talking, you know, and a young lady said to me that, sir, some of the girls, just push your hand. They've done in your clothes, sir, and feel up a bit. I said, what are you saying to me? He said, yes, sir. Just sit in your lap. And I said, she said, yes, but that is what she knows. And if your child don't know that is wrong, and that is done to your child will just be comfortable with another girl playing with her breast. And before long, you make sure you teach them first. Teach them about the bad touch and the good touch and who should touch a man, who should not touch a man, where. Teach them about that in the home. Don't let them learn that outside. Because I'm telling you, outside is not pretty. Outside is not pretty. It doesn't matter if they go to a Christian school or they go to a government school. It doesn't matter. You need to teach them. Because bad children go to the school, the government school, and good children go there. Bad children go to the Christian school, and good children go there. The bad one might just be the one that approach your child who is attending a Christian school. So we expect you to teach them about those things. Teach them sex education. Teach them those things at home before they go outside. Good. Not just, you don't teach them about the Bible. Teach them also about living in the world out there, because it's a real world. And unless your child is home trained, unless your child stays with you all the time, everywhere you go, and isn't given a chance to socialize with others, they are in danger. So I'm telling you, teach your child. You should be keepers. Keepers at home. And this does not limit a woman. Read Proverbs, when Proverbs 31, you'll find out that a godly woman, woman's activity includes travel. A godly woman will move around. A godly woman will know about business. A godly woman will know about, she have her little garden. She plants her garden and she will teach her child to plant the garden too. A godly woman is investment. Yes, I help to keep the house. Everything don't just come out and go out. I don't know my grandmother always find money. I don't know. She don't have any money. But when emergency, a little bag coming from somewhere, a little something. I don't know. But it's saying that women, you know, you need to teach them about all of those things. To be homekeepers. To be homekeepers. The Greek term keepers, it comes from two words that together mean a major responsibility. So as a keeper, as a homekeeper, mother, grandmother, your major responsibility is to keep the house. That's your major responsibility. Keep the family. Help the house to run smoothly. Let me tell you something. Find a man. Any man at all. Be the Governor General of Jamaica. Be the King of England. Be the first elder, second elder, any elder at church. Be the pastor. You find a man who will tell you that their success was by themselves. Find a man. Find a successful man and look beside him, not behind him. Look beside him and see who you see. A woman. That's how powerful you are, woman. That's how you go back to the Bible and you check the Bible and see how much how much women have influenced this church. Influence us being even here. Influence even Jesus coming to save us. You check and see how powerful you are as women. That's no mistake. You are powerful. And God wants you to use that power in the home to make your home a godly, good home. God wants you to do that. God wants you to do that. The mother is to be the queen of the home. Queen of the home. That's what God expects. Fathers have influence on their children. Fathers, listen to this. Fathers have influence on their children. But fathers have influence on their children. But the father's influence cannot outweigh the influence of the mother. Mothers made greater impression on their children, be it boy or girl. While I'll tell you that it is said biologically, naturally, the boy will tilt toward the mother, and the girl will tilt toward the father. Biologically, that happens. But the mother creates a greater impression on both male and female. So mothers, your home is critically important. The home is the basic unit of
every single thing. Your home is the basic unit. Everything starts there and everything ends there. Therefore, all the artillery of hell is leveled against it. Don't think Satan don't know that. I always say there are two institutions that are taken from heaven to earth, and that's the Sabbath and the family. And Satan knows that, and he's doing everything in his power to disrupt the home, to disrupt the Sabbath, so as mothers, you're expected to hold your family. Hold your family. Hold your family. You need to be obedient to your husbands. You need to be obedient to your husbands. You need to be obedient to your husband. I didn't say that. I didn't say that, Sister Blondie. You need to be obedient to Diego. Yeah? Yeah? Sister Harriet, you need to be obedient to Brother Harriet. Yes? I know if you weren't obedient, how much years gone? 44? Whole heap of years gone, but if you weren't obedient to him, it couldn't happen. Tell the younger woman that you need to be obedient to your husband. Yes? You think it's joke a joke? You think it's something may come to my head? Listen to me though, listen to me. The husband is not superior to the wife. So. Brother White, me know what you think, say, because you're tall and Sister White short. You're superior to her. And when she talks, she have to run behind you like, no, not at all. You're not superior to her. Listen to me carefully. You're not superior to her. I am not superior to my wife. And she's like, let me tell you a secret about me, my personally now. You see what I am now? If it wasn't for my wife, wouldn't be what I am now. You see, in school, even right now in school, if my wife don't help me, me in trouble. Serious trouble. Because I am slow with certain things and she's fast. So while I do my thing, I say, help me, sis. And she come help me. And in no time, it reach where it reach. So I don't think I'm big. I'm not. She's, we work together. And wife, you need to work with your husband. And husband, you need to work with your wife. Both of you need to work together. That's what God wants from us. Working together. Don't believe that you are superior and you're better than. No, not in God's sight. You are not. In God's sight, you are. We're working together. It says that the word of God says that who should submit. She said that she make better grades in school. Yes, I make better grades in school because of my wife. Okay? She don't beat up on me and I don't beat up on her at all. Submission is the word. Submission is not subjugation. A husband is not a dictator. A husband is not a drill master. In the home, using the Bible as a club over the woman should not be doing that. Should not be. Some people do that. You use the Bible as a club. She is in submission to her husband as he gives a loving leadership to the home. It is not so much a chain of command, say, you follow me. No. As it is acceptance of responsibility. There are certain things that you do and certain things that I do. A smile, because there are some men who, if the clothes are on the line, married for many years, and the clothes are on the line outside, and the rain is falling, and the man run outside and take up some clothes, he will not touch some clothes. And that's a fact. That's a fact. Shouldn't be. That man still have some grade up to do. Shouldn't be.
should be. So it's a working together. God, that's what God expects. Wife, it said, submit yourself unto your own husband as unto the law. For the husband is the what? Head of the wife. Now here's the parallel. Here's the parallel to that. Don't miss this one. Even as Christ is what? Christ push around and bully we? So why should me, I push around my wife and bully her? Just as though Christ is the head of the church, the man is the head of the house. But Christ work with us. Hence, husbands, we need to work with our wife. Not bully them, don't push them around, because God, Jesus doesn't do that to us. Jesus never done that to us. A husband is to be to his wife what Jesus is to the church. Loving and caring and kind. This is not for our punishment, but for our protection. We should be there. So watch me now. I can't see how. I cannot see how. A little lizard's walking on the wall, going about his own business, and the lady will never go into the room. I cannot see. But God made us in such a way that as a man, you go run him off the wall, I take him off the wall. And if you have a comfort, take him off. You understand what I'm saying? We should be there to protect, to work with, not to bully, not to push around. The head of every man, the head of every man is Jesus Christ. And the head of every woman is the man. Bible, I didn't say that. It's Bible. Is the man. And the head of Christ is who? God. That's how it is. That you think it's like telling, find 1 Corinthians 11 verse 3, and it will tell you that. Just as God the Son is under God the Father in the Holy Trinity, the wife is under the husband in God's scheme of things. But because God the Father is the head of Christ the Son, does not mean that Christ the Son is inferior to God the Father. Jesus Christ is co-equal. In a similar way, mothers, fathers, we are co-equal to each other. No woman is inferior to a man. We are all the same in Jesus Christ. For there is neither Jew nor Greek, neither. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male or female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. Galatians 3, verse 28. God has given this line of responsibility in the home, and it needs to be taught. A woman who rebels against this will find trouble following her everywhere she goes. If you reach a place where you don't obey God and you feel as if you were the chosen. I was talking to someone yesterday, and they're saying that this person was talking to them. The person is about to get divorced. The person is about to get divorced. And one of the reasons why the person is about to get divorced is because the woman wants to wear the pants in the house. And he said that, look here, I'm me the man, I'm me wear the pants. So before one kill one, we better separate. God is saying that, women, you need to know the role of the man. He's the head of the house. He is the head of the house. That's Bible. We need to respect that and give them respect where respect due. Now, when you don't do that, ladies, trouble will follow you. Trouble with God. If you have a rebellious spirit towards your husband, your problem is not primarily towards your husband, but towards God. Think about it. If you have a rebellious attitude about your husband, the problem is with you and God. Remember that, ladies. If you have trouble in your relationship with your husband, rather than being his completer, you are going to become
his crippler. You'll cripple him. Listen to me carefully, women, mothers. It's your day, mothers. If there'll be trouble in your relationship, there'll be trouble in your relationship with your husband. If you want to compete against him rather than working with him, I must tell you also that you'll have problems, you'll have trouble with your children. If you are not under the leadership or the headship of your husband, you are not going to have spiritual authority with your children. Remember, the husband is the head of the house. So the husband is expected to ensure that there's worship. But sometimes, if you as the mother have to wake the husband and wake the children, yes, he's the head. Yes, he's responsible. But sometimes he works so hard that he sleeps longer than usual. So you have to wake him. That's a part of the whole working together. Part of the whole working together, and then work the children. A woman who cannot learn to be under authority. Listen to this one. No, write it down. Write it down. Log it. A woman who cannot learn to be under authority can never be trusted with authority. Again, come again. Again, come again. Listen to it carefully. A woman who cannot learn to be under authority can never be trusted with authority. Trouble with herself. She'll have trouble also with herself. She's not going to have her deepest needs met. Her needs cannot be met. Her needs cannot be truly met because she have trouble with God. You must first be right with God. Be right with your spouse, and everything else the Lord will help you to fix. Some of them will take a long time to fix, but they can fix. Some of them will fix right away. Yes, it will get fixed. The Lord will help you to fix it. Submission does not remove freedom. That is it. When you submit to your husband, it doesn't mean that you are not free. When I am submitted to God, it doesn't mean that I am not free. I have a responsibility. When is a train at its best? When it is parked or when it is moving? When is a train at its best? Or a car or a bike? Is it when it's parked or when it's moving? When it's moving. When it's moving. It's at its best. It's at its best when it is moving. So we are saying that you should give people their freedom. Give people their freedom to move. The word of God shows us how to make a home beautiful. Adorning sound doctrine by the way we live. That's the way of God. Be not blasphemed. When we obey God and we obey his word, we cannot blaspheme his word. Somehow, our generation today, you notice what's happening, friends? Everything quick. Tell me where I don't have quick. I went to a place yesterday, and I waited for to pay a bill. And I waited for around 10 minutes. One person was working, and the person was going so slow. When you enter the business place, it tell you that online banking is the best way, the safest way, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You know what they're doing? Frustrating you to come here, go online, it's faster. No longer people grate a coconut to make rice and peas. Instant powder. That's where we are now, it's instant. No longer you go to the bank to change that to get some cash. You draw your card and go in the machine. Instant cash. That's where the world is now. Instant. Everybody is moving. And that's what this generation is about. instant. No waiting. So if you don't train them to understand that sometimes they have to wait, is that all the time things are going to be coming, things are going to come quickly, not all the time. Then they're gonna join the line. But even when you look around casually, we can tell that something is wrong with the world. The young people nowadays don't respect anybody. Anybody. Anything. They walk past Ella Harriet and I talking, and they walk through the two of us. Not even for an excuse. That's where they are. Move fast moving. So if we don't train our child or children in the home, then our home cannot be a beautiful place. Our home will not be a beautiful place. Bringing a homemaker or being a homemaker is not easy. Being a homemaker is not easy. And it is not glamorous either. But there's no higher calling. There's no greater career in life. It doesn't matter who you are. You're a doctor or a nurse or a teacher or a preacher. It doesn't matter. The greatest of career is to be a homemaker. The greatest of career is to be a homemaker. I'm saying to us today, friends, pray that your home will not be just a place where people live, where people go. Pray that your home may be a beautiful, Christ-centered place. If there's anything God has spoken to you about, I want you to look at it carefully. Look at your situation, where you are with, as a mother, as a grandmother, as a father, as a son. Look at where you are and see how your home can be a better place. See how your home can be a God-centered place. A place where when people come, they don't want to leave because of the aroma, the spiritual aroma that is there. I know that the devil is doing every single thing in his power to mash up the families. I know that. This afternoon, I want to pray. I want to pray for someone, male, female, that the Lord will help your place, your home, to be a Christ-centered place. If you would like to be a part of that prayer, just stand with me this afternoon as we pray. You want your home to be a part of a God-centered place where the children will learn godly things and those who come around you will learn to be godly. Just stand with me as we pray this afternoon. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for your grace that enables us to have godly homes. Lord, we pray now that you'll take this word and mold over hearts with it. I pray especially for the younger generation that has gotten so far away from the basic and beautiful truth you have given. Work, dear Lord, in our hearts. Help us raise up a generation of young people who will learn and love and live in a godly way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Special, you are a call to the mothers in Zion. Not just mothers, but even the fathers as well.
And there are fathers who mother.
Indeed, indeed.
There are fathers who mother. And the admonition has been given to us to secure the home. And our home should be a little heaven on earth. So if we start with a little heaven on earth, then we are preparing a generation that will look forward to the path that we will walk to heaven. Great admonition indeed to the to the mothers and to the fathers and the grandmothers mm-hmm. and aunts, and even those who have not biologically mothered,
yes,
but they are, we have them here in our space here at church.
Mm-hmm.
You would have mothered, and may God grant us the responsibility, the awesome responsibility. May we see the urgency of the time, and we see what is happening around us. And God requires us at this time. And that's why he has given us that task.
Indeed.
To mother and to mother godly as he desires of us.
Indeed. Is that the end of it for
not
today, Nisha?
Not at all. Not at all. We will resume with the study of the word. And
yes.
That's where we get our food, our necessary food. And we begin at...
We'll begin at 3:30 p.m. with our Bible class. And for those who don't know, we'll be doing a follow-up from the Sabbath school lesson this morning. So also, after our Bible class, we'll have our AY program, and you can't afford to miss it.
That one will be centered on mothers as well.
Indeed, indeed. So you can look forward to that. And if you are at home and you live close by, you can join us in the physical space. There's a lot of room here for you to join us. But if you're unable to come, please remember to share the link with a friend so that they can receive a blessing well. It was a pleasure worshiping with you today in the physical space and in the virtual space. And we look forward to seeing you this afternoon at our Bible class. So until then, and for AY as well. So until then, I'm Davion Nelson.
I'm Nisha Palmer Murray. Remember, we have been taught to teach.
Yes.
To go and spread.
Amen. Over to the praise team.
Okay, our closing hymn is 579. Tis love that makes us happy.
Let us stand.
Tis love that makes us happy, tis love that smooths the way. It helps us smile, it makes us kind to others every day. God is love, we are his little children. God is love, and we should be like him. Tis love that makes us happy, tis love that smooths the way. It helps us smile, it makes us kind to others every day.
This world is full of sorrow.
This world is full of sorrow, of sickness, death, and sin. With loving heart we'll do our part and try some souls to win. God is love, we are his little children. God is love. It's love that makes us happy, it's love that smooths away. It helps us smile, it makes us kind to others every day. And when this life is over and we are caught above, our song shall be eternal in of Jesus and his love. God is love.
Let the church say amen.
Let us pray. Our Father, our God, you have spoken unto us. We
have listened, may you grant us the willpower to do as you have commanded, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken, so let the church say amen.
Let the church.
So let the church.